Good evening and happy Earth Day. I'm Christina Sappi, State Representative in Chester County. Welcome to a conversation this evening on pollinators. As you know, Pennsylvania's top industry is agriculture, and here in the Southeast, we are in we have a gem here with a lot of our public gardens, which we learned a lot about this morning at a policy hearing that I hosted over at Longwood Gardens. But just a couple of things about pollinators. Here in the United States, one-third of all agriculture output depends on pollinators. It's estimated that pollinators contribute $24 billion to the United States economy, of which honeybees account for $15 billion. A study by the Bee Informed Partnership found across the United States that beekeepers lost 43.7% of their colonies between April of 2019 and April 2020. And so this is something, if you are joining us on Earth Day to talk about pollinators, you probably have an interest in gardening and agriculture and our natural resources. So I think you're probably also getting a lot of emails from some of our advocacy groups that are very concerned about our bee population. So this is why we're talking about this. I'm a member of the Agriculture Committee in the House, and so we are looking for ways to protect and preserve our pollinator population and increase in a way that is beneficial for agriculture and also for, residents and citizens of the Commonwealth. As such, I'm introducing some legislation currently circulating a co-sponsorship memo, which means that other members of the House will sign on to this legislation to protect and provide spraying notifications when companies are out spraying pesticides. They would need to give 24-hour notice to an apiary that would be within 500 feet of a spray area. We currently have statute that requires a pesticide sprayer to notify homeowners that may be sensitive. You can register to be notified when spraying will occur if you are a sensitive person to any of those chemicals. And this would kind of be a very similar effort there. Another thing we've been working on basically since I got into office in 2018 is we're researching a way to prevent us from using the neonicotinoids that are killing our bee populations. And the problem that we're having is we need a effective, efficient, and affordable way for agricultural use as well. So we are looking at ways that other states have done this. An outright ban on neonicotinoids is obviously what we would love, but it's not necessarily prudent, when agriculture is such an important part of our economy, to just do that without having replacements. So tonight we have a wonderful panel. We're going to be talking about how we can protect our pollinators, ways that we can encourage pollinators on our own properties and in our communities. And so without further ado, I'm going to be introducing our panel here, and they'll give you a brief introduction to their work, and then we will have time for questions. So first, I'd like to introduce Megan Hopkins-Dorr. Megan is the coordinator and master gardeners of Chester County and the Penn State Extension. Welcome, Megan.
Thank you. I'm excited to be here tonight. And so, as mentioned, my name is Megan Hopkins-Dorr. I'm with Penn State Extension. And so I'm very fortunate to be the coordinator for Chester County Master Gardeners, as well as the Master Watershed Stewards in Chester and Delaware County. Both groups focus on native plants and supporting our environment through our behaviors, as well as restoration work. And the Master Gardeners do a lot with pollinator certification and letting people know about what they can do in their own backyards, while the Watershed Stewards do things on public lands with watershed associations and then outreach to homeowners about different efforts they can do too.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening. Next, we have Sean Quinn, who is the Preserve Manager at Cheslin Preserve from Natural Lands Trust. Thanks so much for joining us, Steve.
Good evening. Happy Earth Day, everybody. My name is Sean Quinn. I work with Natural Lands. If you're not familiar with Natural Lands, we are the region's largest land conservation organization. We have 43 nature preserves and one public garden. I have the privilege of working at our Cheslin Reserve, which is Chester County's largest nature preserve, located in Newland Township at nearly 1,300 acres. And so what I'm going to bring tonight is How do you manage your land, whether it's a park or your own private property or maybe a corporate center? And how can you convert some of that turf grass, some of that boring lawn area into valuable habitat that ultimately will benefit not just pollinators, but everything else that the whole food chain relies on? So at Cheslin Reserve, 1,300 acres, there's just two of us. So managing time and managing the land go hand in hand. So with such little staff, my goal is to minimize the amount of time I spend mowing grass and how I can turn that area into a natural area. So my goal is that you'll do the same for yourself.
Thank you so much. And I apologize, John. I called you Steve. And Steve is our next panelist. Steve Rapaski is the president of the Pennsylvania State Beekeepers Association, joining us from Pittsburgh this evening. Hi, Steve.
Hi, Representative. Thank you for having me here tonight. And good evening to everybody out there. My name is Steve Rapaski. I'm the current president of the Pennsylvania State Beekeepers Association. I wear a number of hats, sit on a number of board of directors for the Center of Pollinator Research at Penn State, the Eastern Apicultural Society, past board member for the American Beekeeping Federation. So heavily involved. I'm a second generation beekeeper, run about 200 colonies up and down I-79 corridor in Western Pennsylvania. As the association, we are an all volunteer organization. And certainly as the name suggests, we are focused on beekeepers, but certainly we recognize the interest in pollinators and the value that the native pollinators especially have in our Commonwealth. You know, a lot of people don't think of Pennsylvania as a major contributor to agriculture, but we really are in terms of apples and a lot of these other different cherries and other fruits. And honeybees are important, but so are the other natives. And we kind of push people not only just to become beekeepers or be aware of beekeeping, but also find ways to help people support beekeepers without actually becoming a beekeeper, because there are challenges involved with pesticides and whatnot in keeping bees alive over the last 10 or 15 years. But we're here to help and address and answer any questions you folks may have.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. I'm sure we have a lot of questions to get to. I'm going to introduce Tyler Arkatin, my chief of staff, who's going to be fielding questions from our viewers this evening.
Thank you, Rep. And I just want to remind our viewers, and first off, thank our panelists for joining us. We're really looking forward to this, and we do have great questions coming in. Anybody watching can still submit questions to repsappy@pahouse.net. That's repsappy@pahouse.net. And we will try to get to as many questions as we can tonight. The first question, we're going to start with something that may seem simple, but what are pollinators and what make them different than other insects and why they're important?
Megan, I think that's a good question for you to start off with.
Sure. So pollinators can take actually a whole bunch of different forms. We often think of our bees, but it includes butterflies, some mammals such as bats, and hummingbirds for birds, other things like that. So it's a wide range. And I should definitely mention our wasps and beetles because they're things that we often don't think of. And so they provide the biological service of helping plants reproduce through the pollination process of visiting different flowers, whether a plant can reproduce on its own or it needs the same species and cross-pollination. And I don't know if you guys would add more things to that.
I think that was perfect.
Excellent, thank you. And so this next question actually comes from a conversation that was started offline before we went live tonight, but I think it'd be great for homeowners. Steve, could you provide a little bit of a helpful guide in or summary in identifying a honeybee versus other bees that people will find in their backyard and what to do when you come across them?
That's a great question. And that's actually a 12 credit college course to cover that answer. Because it's very expansive. And as I guess the easiest way is to, you know, we have to be informed, and, you know, whether it's an informed homeowner, whether it's an informed resident of a community, you know, Google is at our fingertips now. And the unfortunate thing is for years, I mean, since I was a kid, even, you know, society has this fear of stinging insects. And that's as a result of running over a yellow jacket when they're mowing the lawn, getting stung by wasps on a swing set. You name it, we've all had that negative experience from some type of a quote unquote bee. And unfortunately, that term has been applied to all stinging insects. It doesn't matter whether it's one of the 400 native species that we find here in Pennsylvania, or when it's some of the nasty ones like your yellow jackets, wasps, and hornets are termed bees. So as far as identification is concerned, this time of year especially, a lot of our native pollinators are very active. They're one of the earliest insects to come out in terms of pollinators. Certainly the moths and butterflies are coming out here as we speak in some parts of the Commonwealth. And the honeybees are certainly active as well. But I get a lot of calls about the mason bees that are around people's doors or in the patio furniture and the weep holes of windows. And it's always, the calls I get are, I know honeybees are endangered, I want to save whatever it may be, or I have bees flying around my soffit and fascia and my roof line, and I don't want to kill them because I want to save them. And they might be carpenter bees, they might be wasps. So what it boils down to is having great resources available to our residents to take a look. So full disclosure, I also run a pest control company that deals with stinging insects. And on my website, we have a whole page dedicated to identifying your insect. And it's very general, but it at least allows people to, one of these things does not belong type of a deal, right? And Penn State Extension is another great resource. The Center for Pollinator Research at Penn State, all of these places, there's a lot of research or a lot of the ability for residents to go out and kind of research on their own and at least find out if it's a good bug or bad bug or a good bee versus a bad bee. So it's difficult to get into the details of it, but certainly I think the easiest way is if it's fuzzy, it's a good bee. If it's shiny and smooth, there's a good chance it's probably not a good bee. But certainly the term bee is very widespread, and we have to be careful how we use that as well.
That is so helpful because I have shiny and fuzzy. I have lots of shiny and fuzzy everywhere around my door, everywhere. And I think Tyler picked up on this. This is what we were talking about before we went live. But that's extremely helpful for homeowners to know, which are beneficial and which are not. So thank you.
Sure. And Megan, would you like to jump in?
I would. I just wanted to share if a homeowner or others can take a photo of the insect that they're trying to identify, the Master Gardeners have a garden hotline. They're volunteers, but they're waiting to help homeowners with questions about identifying an insect, plant disease, etc. And so for Chester County, it's chestermg@psu.edu. And I can send that to Tyler to send out afterwards. Again, they are open and waiting. Right now, we're all working from home. So if you need to call us by phone call, have a little patience as we get back to you. Emails are much faster.
Thank you for that. The next question, specifically to Pennsylvania, and if there are details on Chester County, we'll certainly take that. But for Pennsylvania, what are the common impacts or negative impacts to bee colonies? Is it usually pesticides, or is it disease, or is it a lack of environment?
Yes. Yes seems to be a good answer for a lot of the questions. Back in 2006, colony collapse impacted the honeybee industry. And since then, there's been a lot of research done. And colony collapse in that pure form, it was a description for a set of symptoms that was found in honeybee colonies. And we haven't seen those symptoms to define that as colony collapse probably in the last 7 years or so. But what we have found throughout this research that we've been doing, especially through Penn State and some of the other colleges and universities in Pennsylvania, is that we've narrowed it down to what we call the four P's, which is pesticides, pathogens, poor nutrition, and pests. And those four factors really will vary year to year on the impact of honeybee colonies. And 1 year it might be a drought, so we have poor nutrition, but we also have a lack of habitat because, as Sean mentioned earlier about, the the need to not mow your lawn is very important. You know, killing dandelions and clover, which is two major sources for not only honeybees, sources of pollen and nectar for honeybees, but also for many of the other pollinators. When we have this clean and green atmosphere in our landscape, it really creates this food desert, if you will. So that has an impact. Incorrect use of pesticides. I don't want to say just pesticide use in general is bad, because using a pesticide according to the label, which is the law, is not a bad thing. It's when you use it incorrectly. And we see that all the time by people going to these large box stores, buying herbicides and pesticides. And if a little is good, a lot more is better. And that's actually quite the opposite. So those four P's, the pest, pathogens, poor nutrition, and pest, really have an impact on not only on the honeybee population, but we're also seeing that impact flow over to our bumblebees and some of our other natives as well.
The next question, we've had a couple actually come in referencing the spotted lantern fly and trying to address that. And Steve, I don't know if it has made it to Pittsburgh yet, but it's very much in our district here. And a lot of homeowners are trying to grapple how to tackle it. So could you provide any tips for homeowners that are concerned about negatively impacting pollinators, but also trying to address the spotted lantern fly?
Yeah, and I think Megan, you'll probably want to jump on this too, as far as, you know, we definitely have it. We had spotted lantern fly show up 2 years initially ago, and then last year, not in the massive numbers that you folks have out in the Southeast, but we are certainly here, we're under quarantine. But what we have found from a beekeeping standpoint for honeybees, especially in that southeastern part of the state, there tend to be what we call a nectar dearth in the late summer, early fall. So there wasn't a lot of blooming plants. So beekeepers were often not harvesting a lot of honey in order to keep it for the bees, but also supplementing that honey with artificial food in terms of sugar and things like that to kind of boost the weight of those hives to go into the winter. Well, with the spotted lantern fly, what they have found is that the honeydew that's secreted by these spotted lantern flies is actually, it's a sugary substance, and the bees love it. And they've actually put on quite a bit of weight and actually survived the winter very well on this honeydew secretion from the lantern fly. So a bad bug is providing something good, just like we see with Japanese knotweed, for instance, a very invasive plant, but it puts out a fabulous nectar and puts on a lot of honey for the bees and beekeepers, which we like. So there's a benefit to the spotted lantern fly, which is the honeydew, but that has to be balanced with the negative aspects of the homeowner, you know, the way the lantern fly is just the secretion gets all over the cars, right? It's just that bugs everywhere and creepy crawlies and people don't like it. So certainly the spotted lantern fly is a good thing in terms of putting on the secretions from the honeydew for the bees themselves going into winter. On the flip side of that, we have to balance that because it is now an invasive non-native that I think Megan can address in terms of what homeowners can do, because they are just everywhere and will continue to be, apparently.
Steve is much more favorable to spotted lantern fly than I feel. Kind of feel the same way when people are like, oh, they're so beautiful. I'm like, no, they're beautiful dead, not here. Yes, they do excrete honeydew. And so there's actually a real problem with killing off understory plants because of that honeydew, because it falls from the higher tree canopy where the spotted lantern flies may be sitting, falls down, covers the area under it, whether it's steps, structures for homeowners, understory plants, whether it's your herbaceous or your shrubs, smaller trees, things like that. And that honeydew can grow sooty mold, which blocks the sunlight from reaching the leaves and so prevents photosynthesis. And so they found definite dieback from that, as well as loss of yield from orchards. So they are a very big problem in terms of our agriculture and not just a landscape pest for homeowners. In terms of getting stuff off of your structures, power washing is the best method, but you're still going to have some of that remaining discoloration. Your understory plants, the best thing to do is to try and keep them from going up the nearby tree. And so there are different ways to remove them, whether it is chemical, mechanical. We're still searching for a biological control. We don't have there are generalist predators like your praying mantis and things like that that eat them, some of our birds, but nothing that's going to control them. And so Penn State Extension is definitely recommending, especially those mechanical controls. We did come out originally with the sticky traps. We still recommend those, but 100%, you have to put on a wildlife excluder for them. And we no longer recommend the chicken wire. We recommend screen to go around with it. There's lots of videos and things out there for how to properly install them. And what we're now pushing even more than that is the circle traps, because we're finding that enough homeowners aren't putting on the wildlife excluders, which you don't want to trap a bird or other creature accidentally as bycatch. So with the circle traps, there's less insects other than spotted land flies that are getting up there. There are ways to make them yourself, and there's a few companies that produce them. It could be a business opportunity if someone in this area wants to start making them as well.
Megan, quick question for you. If I'm we have a lot of folks moving into Chester County, young families, first-time homeowners. Could you explain what an understory plant might be?
Oh, sure. So it is your smaller trees, like your red bud, which don't reach to those large oak canopy type things. You can also have your shrubs.
How are you? Good. How are you doing? Good.
Personally concerned about my service bearing.
I don't know.
Hold on. That's me. Sorry.
Oh, really? Okay.
Sorry about that. So understory just refers to the height and canopy that it can reach to.
Okay. So those are generally plantings that would be around the home then, underneath the windows, foundational beds.
It's actually often so. Your spotted lanternfly are attracted to, there's 70 plus host plants, so there's a lot of different things that they like, and they will move seasonally depending on which plant has the highest torpor pressure, which is how quickly everything moves through there, as well as producing the most sugar, because they like a lot. And so in my case, we have 5 black walnuts in our yard. And so they're very tall trees. It's the shrubs and ferns and things that are underneath of them that are starting to die back because of that honeydew. So that's more what I mean. They can be on a house for a brief period of time, but mostly they're moving around to try and feed. So they're not going to be there for long periods of time. Although certainly enough to be irritating. For many people. And I can say one of our master gardeners loves to use a shot vac to suck them up whenever they are within reachable distance. There's lots of different mechanical methods for controlling them. And if you are using chemical control methods, just make sure, like Steve was saying, to purchase something that is effective for spotted lanternfly and not to overuse something, because the label is the law.
Thank you. So the star of our show tonight are pollinators, and we could talk about spotted lanternfly until the cows come home, because it's impacted us so much. And in our agriculture, we have a lot of vineyards in the 158th and a lot of growing here. So it's definitely of great concern. But Tyler, do we have another question?
We certainly do. So we have a couple questions from homeowners interested in what they can do at home and what they can do to their own property. So John, I'm wondering if you could get us started on some simple tips with if somebody has excess land or just a small area they're willing to dedicate to pollinators.
Sure. The biggest thing is stop mowing so much grass. Not only is it boring to mow grass every week, it takes up a lot of time and time you could be spending with your family or a hobby, but creating habitat in your yard. What I found out is when you want to attract pollinators, it's not so how much big your piece of land is. It's the quality of the habitat you create. So even if you don't have much grass, you could just take a corner of your yard, take it out of turf grass, a portion that you find that you're not using very much anymore, maybe turning it into a wildflower meadow. Or maybe you take that corner of the yard and put a brush pile there for attracting bumblebees. Even if you don't have much grass at all, you just have forest land, leave those dead trees on the ground. Let them be. Dead trees on the ground are important, not just for pollinators, but so many insects up and down the food chain. So the biggest thing is just stop mowing your grass. And we were speaking earlier today about, you know, you may have a spouse who doesn't want to mow anymore, and you may have a spouse who may want that really great lawn area. If that great lawn area serves a purpose for outdoor partying, playing outside, volleyball court, that's great. Keep it if you're using it. But if you have an area that you're just not using, that you're just mowing every week, even if it's in your front yard where your neighbors can see, turn it into a meadow, turn it into a wildflower meadow. Attract those pollinators, plant those beautiful flowers. I don't know anybody who says they don't like the way flowers look. I know lots of people who don't like the way a green yard looks. It's just bland to a lot of folks, I'm included. So big thing is just stop mowing, and we can get further in depth about, all right, you make that step to stop mowing your grass, then what? There's certain seasonal things you do. So you don't mow, you don't rake your leaves in the fall. You wait till maybe this time of year to do that, because you need a place for the bees to overwinter. So if they're not honeybees, which are going to be in a hive, your solitary bees, your bumblebees need stumps, they need sticks, they need cavities, they need the ground, they need tufts of grass, they need sort of that scrubby area. So if you can create that scrubby area, not only are you providing the habitat, but you're saving yourself a lot of time and money by not mowing it every day, every week.
A quick follow-up question on that. So if you were to stop mowing a section, well, first of all, I think, you know, a lot of people live in communities either with a homeowners association or there may be municipal ordinances around mowing. So that's something that I think this is a good conversation. I think we're just starting to see, you know, where we go with that. But the one thing that we're very concerned about here in the Southeast, and I know I just said pollinators are the star of the show, so forgive me for going in the different direction for a moment, but we're also really concerned about Lyme disease. So Lyme disease, you know, high grass, mosquitoes breeding, you know, we're also concerned about West Nile. Are there any concerns around how that, you know, we want to encourage pollinators with less mowing. There's a downside, I believe. Can you comment on that?
Sure. So let's say you're in a community that has a homeowners association. There may, in many cases, be a common area that the community shares. And a lot of times that may just be a retention basin that's in grass or whatever. Many times it's just a field or just a mown area. Generally, if the grass is tall, nobody's really going in there. Right. So the risk of getting ticks is pretty low, no more than taking a hike in the woods. But the nice thing about having a meadow, if you can create a meadow, whether it's large or small, you can cut a 6-foot wide trail on it, a hiking trail. So if, let's say, if your homeowner association has 40 acres of common space, it could become a 40-acre meadow with a couple of trails in it that are mowed grass, that are free of ticks. And so that's a great idea. And same thing with schools, with surplus turf grass that's not necessary. Coatesville School District comes to mind, where the elementary, I guess middle school was torn down across from the Chester County Hospital. Just massive, massive fields of mown turf grass that could be turned into a wonderful meadow and a great opportunity for education for students in the school district as well. So there's plenty of parks, community parks, public parks that are sort of in the same game, but they're just mowing so much turf grass. Yes, you may want your ball fields, and that's totally fine. But the area around the ball fields that are just being mowed for no good reason could be into beautiful meadows with lots of different flowers that attract so many different pollinators.
Thank you.
If I can quickly add, in terms of the homeowner side for that too, one of the things we found is a lot of it also has to do with aesthetics. So if you are dealing with certain regulations for keeping your lawn a certain height or things like that, if you add a pathway through there and keep the edges lower, either with ground cover or mowed around the sidewalk area, it may it makes it obvious that somebody is caring for it, that area, and so tends to make it more pleasing. There's also signs that you can put in. There's also a certification type signs that act as educational resources as well.
Great, thank you.
And as a follow-up to this, if somebody is looking to plant flowers, where should they start with that? Are there what flowers should they be looking for? And are there any programs that help people with pollinator starting kits for free or cheaply or any type of discounts like that?
I can at least start that conversation off. I'm going to promote our pollinator certification process through the Department of Entomology, not just because of the certification program and the sign you can get, but because it is such a great resource in terms of listing all the things for seasonal blooms, providing water sources, the things that can really help you plan out your space to provide for pollinators. So if nothing else, go through, look at the resources, use that to then determine what kind of shrubs, trees, herbaceous plants, so your flowering things and grasses that you want to add to your space. And then find a spot to have a snag, maybe if you have a tree that's dying in your yard or your brush pile, like Sean said.
You don't have to be versed in knowing all your native plants, but getting native plants is really the key here, because we want the native pollinators to survive and flourish. One of the folks we use at Natural Lands is Ernst Conservation Seed. It's probably backwards for y'all, but they're out of Western Pennsylvania, and they provide seed mixes for all different types of habitat. And so if you're in southeastern Pennsylvania and you want a mix of warm season grasses and wildflowers, you just go to their website and pick out what fits for your habitat. If you just want to stand up just wildflowers, or let's say you have an area that gets kind of wet, they have everything you need pre-mixed for the habitat type that you have. So you order up based on the area you want to plant, comes to you and you plant it. It's simple as that. So you don't really need to go too in-depth about knowing all your plants. Let the experts take care of that for you.
Steve, you're muted.
Okay, there we go. It's been a bad technology day for me. There's also a good website, pollinator.org, which is the Pollinator Partnership, which has regional planting guides. So if you don't not even know what type of plant you want or what type of flower, there's a nice regional planting guide for the northeast and southwest of the United States. But it'll give you a list of a lot of different perennials and annuals that you could use that are pollinator friendly. And then Sean pointed out, Ernst has been a great partner here in Pennsylvania with a number of organizations, including the State Beekeeping Association. We've got beekeepers that have hives on their properties up there, so our bees are pollinating their plants that are producing the seeds, and we're getting some really neat, unique honey flavors off of that. But the point is, they have everything for whether it's super dry to super wet to everything in between. You could order, 1 pound or 500 pounds of seed and mix and match, and they're really great to work with, and that's a good resource that we have here in the Commonwealth.
Thank you. That's fantastic. And I think we'll probably be sharing these links, for this information on our social media and on our website after the event. So thank you.
Yep, we can definitely do that. And we have one homeowner that is asking specifically, maybe Megan, if you can provide some examples of a sun option and a shade option for them. But also as a follow-up to that in a more general way, if homeowners are going to a nursery or going to actually buy some plants, is there something they should be looking for to make sure it isn't pre-treated or anything like that?
Yes, you definitely. So I'll start with the second question first. You definitely want to find out what kind of treatment is going on. If it is a smaller nursery, talk to people that work there. They should be able to give you an answer. Your larger box stores, it's more challenging to find out. And so your independent nurseries tend to be a better resource. Also look for what native plant nurseries are around. There are definitely lists online for across the area. And then for those that sell both native and non-native plants, tell them with your purse book that you appreciate those native plants, because that's what's going to drive the things that they order from the growers in the future. For shade and sunny suggestions, there are so many great ones. Probably one of my favorites are just cardinal plants in Lobelia family. They attract hummingbirds and other pollinators, and they're just beautiful. Those can deal with partial shade, although they prefer a little more sun. And then Joe Pye is a great sunny plant that can be in a rain garden, so it can deal with periods of wet and periods of dry. If you're concerned that a Joe Pye is too tall for your section, they do have shorter versions available. If you are looking at plants, we've talked a bunch about natives. Keep in mind that if you go with a dwarf variety of a plant, of a native plant, it is typically not changing the attraction to pollinators, because if you change the leaves and the flowers, that is changing structurally the plant and how they support the pollinators, because they develop together. But that's a long conversation.
I think another big thing is just diversity, especially in colors of flowers. So all flowers are beautiful, but if you get a good variety of different colors, it's going to attract different pollinators. So you're going to get the bees and the butterflies, as long as you have different colors and that they're flowering in the spring, summer, and into the fall. So you don't want to just get flowers or plants or shrubs that are going to be just great in the spring but do nothing for you in the fall.
Sean, that just brings up a question for me. We hear a lot about butterfly bush, and I think a lot of folks have butterfly bush, you know, in their gardens or in their landscape, and they bring great joy to watch all of the different types of butterflies that come. But I have heard that they're not actually helping our butterfly population. Can one of you comment on that? Is that the butterfly bush situation?
So yeah, just to make sure that, you know, butterfly weed is a great native plant we love. Butterfly bush is an invasive plant that I think if it's well controlled in your own little private garden in the back of your house, it's fine. It's when it spreads into large landscapes is when it becomes, I think, a real issue. But from a biological standpoint, I'll let my other colleagues come in on that.
Well, they all have all these plants have a purpose, right? Some are host plants to some species and others. It all depends on what your main focus is. Are you looking to just, you know, stick to pure natives and attracting pure natives? You know, what's your landscape look like? I mean, you know, butterfly bush has its purpose and it's in its specific spot, but it may not be for your yard and your goals in mind. So it's, you know, it's out there. You know, you can, it's another long discussion about, you know, benefits of one plant versus another. And, you know, we could argue, you know, sunflowers are great for pollinators. It produces a lot of good pollen, but they're also annuals. You know, some aren't native, and it just gets into a real deep, dark rabbit hole on these kind of things.
Right. And that's one of the challenges. You hear something's an invasive plant, you sort of pause, but then you're like, well, you know, there's barberry bushes that you can buy at the nursery, and they are, you know, ticks nest in those, and they're, you know, considered invasive. So, and yet there they are. So, you know, butterfly bush attracts all of these butterflies, but then we're hearing that they're not actually feeding the butterflies, that they can actually be, you know, harmful. So it's when you see it at the nursery in the landscape shop, you know, and then there's conflicting information there about, you know, what we should be purchasing and how it works. But I like, Steve, your comment about it all serves a purpose. So that's helpful too.
I will also add, if there is something that is designated as invasive, but it has a special attachment to you, if you just prevent it from going to seed, that helps out a lot. So if you cut those flowers before they go to seed, and so you're not allowing it to spread, because our birds feed on a lot of things and mm-hmm. spread them. Same with other ways that invasive spread. And they are called invasive for a reason. Mm-hmm. I know some of our master gardeners who have beloved invasives. And so, yes, they make sure that the seeds aren't able to spread. And that way they feel comfortable keeping them in their yard.
I know some of those folks too.
Think we all do.
It's like, but I can't imagine just sitting and watching and waiting, to, you know, like now it's time. Now it's time to, you know, go run out there and before it goes to seed. Yeah.
It goes the other way too. I mean, mints are a perfect example too. I mean, mints are technically, I mean, they're invasive in the sense of they take over everything.
They really
they're
do.
They're great for pollinators, but you'd also want to leave room for everything else. So, you know, you need to containerize, and I mean, you almost have to have a goal in mind. And even some of the things going back to what to plant and referring to the butterflies, you know, sometimes we don't see the stuff that's right in front of us. So if you've ever planted dill in your gardens, dill is a fantastic host plant for a lot of different butterflies. And we think of it as, you know, plant in the garden and use it for whatever, but you could easily just plant that as a homeowner, as a non-garden type of thing, and let it go to seed and provide a host plant for a butterfly. It's not super pretty. It doesn't, you know, look nice, but it does provide a very important role in that whole micro ecosystem that you have in your backyard. So.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
We have a viewer who is asking about how to partner with beekeepers. They have a piece of property that they would like to see more pollinators on. And is it possible to rent a bee box or to partner with a beekeeper in any way like that?
Absolutely. Yeah, we have 38 different local beekeeping clubs in Pennsylvania. If you go to our website, pastatebeekeepers.org, and look up the local associations and find the one nearest to you, there's always beekeepers, not always, there's many times beekeepers looking for additional locations, even as for a location to put their first hive, because their yard might be too small. So, you know, maybe somewhere across town, there is a location. So checking with your local beekeeping association, you know, interacting with them, go to your local farmer's market, you know, support, you know, buy local, shop local, support your local beekeeper, not only by purchasing their honey and their hive products, but you also get to meet the beekeeper and have that discussion with them. And oftentimes if they can't or aren't able to do it, we have a vast network of many other beekeepers in our communities that we might be able to put you in touch with. So,
at Natural Lands, we partnered with the Chester County Beekeepers Association. So here at Cheslin Preserve, we have an apiary that the beekeepers have built. And so it's great. We have probably 24 hives in a small little area. And anybody who has any kind of fear about living amongst the bees, I literally live across the street from the apiary with more than 24 hives. My children play outside all the time, and we've never had a negative interaction with any of the bees. Actually, they actually ask almost every day during this time of year is to go over and see the bees. And so those of you who are interested in getting into it but are a little bit timid about, are they safe? I think we all can agree that they're plenty safe.
Quick question. I love this topic, obviously, because I keep butting in. So sorry. How can you tell us how far they travel?
Upwards of three
yeah. distances to find food and then to bring back to the hive.
Yeah, absolutely. So they travel upwards of 3 miles to forage. So, you know, that's a quite a distance. And I think one of the things that you get, especially in the urban suburban areas with people in that fear factor, is you talk to a beekeeper and they tell you, oh, there's 30,000 bees in a colony. And that non-beekeeper envisions 30,000 bees leaving for work every day and coming back in these massive swarms. And it's quite the opposite. Only about a third of those bees come and go at any given time because of the various biological, you know, life cycles that they're in. But yeah, they can travel up to 3 miles, which is also ties into the importance of homeowners, you know, not mowing their lawn constantly or not putting chemicals on their lawn and planting that little back corner of their backyard or their front yard with little, you know, natives and, you know, perennial pollinator friendly plants, because the fact that those bees travel so far, every little bit helps. So when we took a large landscape and basically just demolished it with all this green, I'll call it green space, but not good green space, we need to put that patchwork back together and tie all of that landscape with good pollinator-friendly plants. So.
Thank you.
And in the same realm of partnering with beekeepers, if you had an unwanted beehive on your property, what would be the process in getting that safely off the property? Is there a way to do that?
Yeah, absolutely. Again, it goes back to your local associations. You know, as a state association, we deal with Harrisburg. We deal with the legislative issues and the stuff that affects all beekeepers. But your local associations are the ones that you're going to contact. If this time of year especially, bees are getting into what we call swarm season, where they're building very quickly. They're over extending the room in the hive that they have, whether it's in a tree or somebody's colony. They split in half and they will land temporarily on somebody's tree, shrub, stop sign, you name it, in a large cluster about the size of a football. That's where a lot of these local associations have a swarm contact list and other additional contacts. Pick up the phone, call them before you spray, call them before you get afraid of them. Swarms are gentle, they're docile, they're just looking for a place to live. Call a beekeeper, and a lot of them will come and do it for free, and they'll relocate them and give them a new home.
Just to touch back on what a homeowner can do if they don't have the land or a beehive, or they're maybe don't want to do it themselves. Of course, honeybees are the rock star of the pollinator world. One, because they do so much work and they give us honey as well, but even the solitary bees, your bumblebees, mason bees, things like that, anybody can create little tiny bee hotels or insect hotels. They're a great project for kids. I think they'd be a great fundraising project for any kind of scout group. I mean, the Girl Scouts make wonderful cookies, but selling bee houses would be really cool too. So even if you want to provide some kind of habitat, but you may not have the lawn space or anything, even an apartment, you could just stick this little bee hotel outside the window. They're easy to make. Plans are all over the internet, and they're a great project for kids as well.
Absolutely. Yeah, we 100% agree with that, Sean. I mean, like I said, we are focused on beekeeping and honeybees at the state level and even local level, but we recognize too that our nearly 400 species of natives here in Pennsylvania are equally as important. I mean, because they actually forage in temperatures lower than honeybees. They're micro foragers, if you will, even though honeybees cover a larger area. Some of these natives are a little bit more efficient. So, promoting that. And a lot of people, I don't think we've actually asked a question. A lot of people ask, well, how do I become a beekeeper? Or what if I want to keep bees? And I'll be flat honest, we don't need more beekeepers. We need more people promoting perennial flowers and habitat growth and not mowing your lawns and things like that. That's where we're going to gain the greater benefit, because not only are you helping the natives, indirectly, you are helping the honeybees and, of course, the beekeepers as well when it comes to that. So, providing that support to the natives is a huge deal, and we need to focus more on that. And we're getting there by doing these meetings and showing that there's more out there than just, the bad bees, the wasp and hornets and the honeybees. There's all these natives that when you really dive into it, I mean, it's a game trying to identify some of those species. It's quite interesting when you start to realize how different and how diverse, of those insects that we have here in Pennsylvania.
Thank you. And while we're talking about species, can we talk about pollinators that are not bees? Can we talk about, I have a feeling there's quite a few different species that are helping to pollinate that we might come across on our property but not know that they're pollinating. Anybody?
Yeah, Megan, if you want, when you can list them, you're talking about bats, you're talking about flies and butterflies and moths. There's a lot out there. I mean, that's another college course in just identifying what's out there. But, one of the things homeowners, and I've noticed it myself too, years ago when this happened, but when you plant that nice little pollinator garden and just stop, the phrase, stop the smell of the roses, stop and watch the bees. I mean, you're going to be amazed at the number of pollinating flies that are out there and moths, even nighttime. I mean, the moths that are pollinating at night is quite unique too. So, yeah, there's a lot out there. And Megan, I'm sure you probably have a lot more to add to that, but that's a whole nother realm with that, that we need to just, you know, be aware as residents of the Commonwealth is that, you know, there's a lot more than what we actually just see in front of our eyes.
I 100% agree. I love going out and looking at different blooming things and seeing, for lack of a better, what critter is crawling around those flowers. You also attract with that biodiversity in your plant matter and however you use your yard. You attract other beneficials and other things. So they're not pollinators, but there is a fly that takes care of carpenter bees. And so the more things you can bring into your yard and less application of unnecessary pesticides, the better off everything is.
Yeah, and she's talking about some of these like parasitic wasps that are native. They're solitary. They're harmless. The mud dauber is one of those. You know, if a mud dauber is a species of wasp that there's several different species, but they build these, you know, tubular mud homes on the sides of houses and in attics. And if you ever, one of them is specifically feeds on spiders. And you know, if you don't like spiders, like I hate spiders, I'm a fan of mud daubers. So you know, you bring those types of things where that biodiversity actually helps where, as Megan said, you reduce that use of chemicals because you're inviting the natural pests or natural predator-prey relationships to grow. And, you know, gardeners know this all the time, is, you know, where you grow certain plants to invite certain species which prey on other bad species. So it's this big circle of life thing that we've kind of disrupted through the use of chemicals. But we need to get back to understanding that not all bugs are bad bugs. Right. There's a lot more good ones than bad ones.
Well, and that, I think that's the thing I'm trying to get at here is people are afraid of a lot of these things, especially if they're moving from an urban area out here into Chester County, you know, first-time homeowners, bats, toads, you know, mud daubers. It's like, this is a little overwhelming out here. So, you know, especially like in September when the temperatures start to drop at night and you get a bat in the house. I mean, I think a lot of us have heard stories about, you know, dad, go get the tennis racket. So what do we, you know, bats are pollinating and they're also having a hard time. They've got their own fungus and fungal issues. What do you do? I know what we do, but.
Education. Yeah, education. It's all about education. It's just, you know, I do a farmer's market every weekend just outside of Pittsburgh in Sewickley. And, you know, the questions that come, and it's great that people, the general public are asking questions. And it boils down, you know, Penn State Extension is out there and the Natural Land Trust and the Western PA, Conservation and all these groups are out there. And it's not only just us educating it. You also have to have the people that want to be educated. You know, they want to be able to have that information not only available but also given to them, and they want to, you know, be intrigued by what's going on. And part of that education is getting them excited about what's out there. And some you can't. I mean, a creepy crawly is a creepy crawly. It doesn't matter how good it is. Get it out of my house. But I think it boils down to, you know, this. This is all what we're doing tonight. You know, educating and letting people know some of the issues that are out there and how they could actually partake as just a resident of Pennsylvania, and how important even just you as a homeowner in Pennsylvania is just important as a master gardener or as a beekeeper or as a representative. You know, we all have to do our part to kind of bring this all back together.
Thank you so much.
Just remember, we live in the age of insects. So there's only 7 billion of us on Earth, but there's a lot more insects. So we are in their world now. And so accepting their existence is great. And especially when you get talking about bats, depends. Would you rather have a bat flying above your head or being bit by insects all evening long when you're trying to hang out? I'd rather have the bat on my side eating the mosquitoes. So education is key. And just remember, we're in their world. So we should all get along with them. It is Earth Day after all.
Right. Right. All living things. Wonderful.
I would also add that a pest is a pest when it's somewhere where you don't want it. So I don't want, as much as I love bees, I don't want one in my home. And so that's when it becomes a pest. But outdoors is where it's supposed to be. And so not bothering me, I'm not bothering it. In fact, I'm actually supporting it by trying to provide food and shelter. And for new homeowners, if they look at how things change over time with different things they can do in their yard, we've lived in our home for 7 years, and I've watched with the addition of, with what I've done with our yard, with different natives, shrubs, habitat, things like that, we've seen a huge blossoming of fireflies in our backyard where there were none when we first came. Tons of different pollinators, lots of different birds, and so you get rewarded by what you put into the land.
Very good point. Thank you.
We've spent a lot of tonight, rightfully so, on homeowners, but I do want to give an opportunity. Are there any resources or initiatives that businesses and nonprofits should be aware of for their properties versus a homeowner?
Sure, I'll take that. I mean, it's if you're a property owner, a business owner, and you have a large piece of land, landscaping around the area, I'm sure it looks great. It's also costing your business a lot of money to have the landscapers come out and mow that every week. And turf grass is great for edges here and there, but you can really transform your business by creating meadows or taking a large turf area and doing something else with it. Even if it's planting trees. I mean, all trees flower. So those flowering trees create habitat and opportunities for pollinators as well. But some of the worst things you can do is just pay somebody to mow large acres of land every week. And especially when things start really growing, you're paying them on average to mow every 5 days. And that gets really expensive. So investing a little bit of money up front and establishing a meadow, a wildflower area, or an afforestation area, or riparian buffers, will cost a little bit up front, but will save you thousands and thousands of dollars in just the second or third year. And then it perpetuates how much money you save. And then you're creating that much more habitat and honestly more curb appeal. You're adding more color to your storefront. You're adding more color to your campus and opportunities to educate folks as well.
Thank you for that, Sean. And I do want to be mindful of everybody's time. So the last question we have is, and honestly, this goes towards Rep. Sappy first. We had a lot of interest from the public tonight, and folks are asking other ways they can get involved in this issue and what they should do to promote pollinators with the legislature or elsewhere.
Thank you. Well, thank you so much, first of all, for caring about our environment, for celebrating Earth Day, for spending, you know, time with us talking about pollinators. I really appreciate that. That's one of the things that's so special about living in Chester County is, you know, the space and the natural resources we have here. And so we really all do play a part in terms of advocating for, you know, legislation that protects our pollinators and supports riparian buffers that Sean just mentioned. You know, obviously I'm working on those issues, but we need to contact legislators that may not know about them or are not, you know, sponsoring. So reach out to our office. We'll be happy to, you know, sort of coach you through some advocacy on that level. But in terms of, you know, what else you can do, I always highly recommend that folks sign up to get, I know you don't want a full inbox, nobody does, but if you're interested in, you know, pollinating or what you can grow and learning more from, you know, from the folks that we've had here this evening, go to their websites, check out what they're doing. You know, I'm sure there's ways for you to ask questions and get in touch, be, you know, sign up for some of their programmings. Sean, I'm definitely gonna be signing up to make a bee hotel with the kids at Natural Lands. That sounds like so much fun. But you know, there's get their emails, their newsletters, sign up. And here's something that's very important. Throughout the pandemic, we've been spending a lot more time outside. And I think this is one of the silver linings of the, you know, terrifically challenging time we are going through, is that we're spending more time outside and appreciating what we have here so much more. So to that end, you know, support these nonprofits and the education programs they're giving us and the care they take of those spaces for us is another great way for us to learn and care for the environment around us. So thank you again to our panelists. I could talk about these things all night long, as I'm sure you can tell. I'm passionate about this issue and look forward to seeing you all soon. Thanks again. Have a good night.
Thank you, Representative.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.